Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let earth and heavenly saints proclaim the power and might of his great name. Let us exalt on bended knee. Praise God the Holy Trinity. Praise God, praise God, praise God who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise to the King, his throne transcends, his crown and kingdom never ends, now and throughout eternity. I'll praise the one who died for me. Praise God, praise God, praise God who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Let's sing the chorus again.
Praise God, praise God, praise God who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Now you can go, Jody.
I'll be the only one who's early today. So. You know what's going to be really funny? About an hour from now, maybe about a dozen people walk in. So here's what I think we ought to do. When they come in, I ought to stand up and go, "Hey, good morning, welcome to Twickenham." And we'll just do this twice today, because some of you need it. So, hey, if you're a guest this morning, thanks for coming out to be with us. Glad you're here at Twickenham. And if there's anything our church can do to help you out, we hope you would let us know. There's a card on the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and place that in the collection plate. That'll pass in just a couple of minutes. And if you have a prayer request, please indicate that on that card. We'll be praying about those as early as tomorrow morning. And you can indicate if you want the whole church to know about it, we'll tell everybody. If you want it just kept private, we'll keep it among the leadership. But we'd love to be praying about those things. Hey, you want to welcome a new family this morning, Shane and Melanie Bashan and their children, Elise, Rosie, and the most beautifully named child in the church, Georgia. And would you guys want to stand up so we can welcome you guys? Glad y'all are here. Glad you're here. Why don't we all stand together? And I've got some bad news and some good news. Here's the bad news. God knows everything about you. Here's the good news. God loves you anyway. Amen. Let's praise the Lord together.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faith you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. You are the everlasting God.
Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
The everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
You won't grow. Grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the
standing as we read from Isaiah. Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you, therefore he will rise up to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. People of Zion who live in Jerusalem, you will weep no more. How gracious he will be when you cry for help. As soon as he hears, he will answer you. Although the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, your teachers will be hidden no more. With your own eyes, you will see them. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, "This is the way. Walk in it." Be seated as we take our offering. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Open now the crystal fountain, whence the healing waters flow. Let the fiery, cloudy pillar lead me all my journey through. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. When I tread the verge of Jordan, bid my anxious fears subside. Bear me through the swelling current, land me safe on Canaan's side. Songs of praises I will ever
songs of praises I will ever give to thee. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. Fall like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again. Sweep away darkness, burn away the chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. There are higher heights, there are deeper seas. Whatever you need to do, Lord, do it in me. The glory of God fills my life. Same again. Fall like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again. Sweep away the darkness, burn away the chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. I've closed the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. No, I will never be the same again. Oh, Master, let me walk. Tell me thy secret, help me bear the strain of toil, the fret of care. Help me the slow of heart to move by some clear winning word. Teach me the wayward feet to stay and guide them in the homeward way. In hope that sends a shining ray far down the future's
pretty new here, and this is the first time that I've led communion, and we were joking before, and you know, Kevin was saying good luck today, and I said, well, what you don't know is that Jody literally sent me an email on what to say from top all the way to the bottom. So I hope we can handle it. But before we left, before I walked away, Jody said, well, you know, if you want to ever do this again, that you'll follow what I wrote in this email. So I think I'll do that. He chose... he wanted me to read out of Titus 2. And that's Titus 2, chapter 2, verse 11 through 14. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Now, there are two truths in this passage. And one of the truths that I heard is that we are 100% saved by God's grace. And I know that with all my heart. And because of that, we are called to live lives of holiness. And in our outward appearance, be good stewards of God's grace. But it's also hard for me to read that passage and not realize that a lot of our lives are not always going to be holy. And there's going to be times in our lives that we fall to old habits or old addictions, or make bad choices, make bad decisions, choose to stray in our marriage, choose to just go off the path that God has directed us down. And when that happens, and when we read a verse like this that's saying that we're called to be holy, and that we're called to be stewards of God's grace and to live holy lives, and then when we don't, it brings us right here. And that's at the foot of a cross of a Savior that loved us so much that he died for us, that he sent his Son, and that we can say boldly with our chest poked out that we are saved by God's grace. Let us pray. Father, we love you so much, and we are so thankful that you sent your Son to die on a cross, that we can call ourselves saved, and that we can call him Savior. Lord, I thank you so much for the grace that was given, and I ask for the boldness to live holy lives. And God, I just ask that if we don't, that we recognize that the only place to be is at the bottom of your cross. And Lord, that your grace covers us. Lord, thank you so much for your body that was broken. Lord, I just ask that we take this and just realize that we are completely saved because of what you did on that cross. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
More like you, Jesus, more like you.
Jump out of line and read something that was not in the email. I hope I get to do this again. Paul gives a charge to Titus in Titus 3. That's one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. And I couldn't read from Titus 2 and not skip over and read this from Titus 3. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of the righteous things that we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Father, we love you so much. I'm so thankful for sending your son to die on that cross. Lord, I'm so thankful for your grace, and I'm so thankful for your mercy. But Lord, I'm just so thankful that you give us an opportunity to live with you one day. Lord, thank you for this cup. Well, I ask that we think about just one drop of blood, Lord, and that was shed for each one of us, and that you know us by name, and because you know us by name, you died for each one of us. We love you so much. We thank you for this day.
More like you, Jesus, more like you. Fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you, Jesus, more like you, Jesus, more. Thank you. mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace, never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing in your grace, evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us.
Be seated, please.
Wes, Wes, Wes. It was a great job, man. And you will definitely do that again. Just not here. And I send people suggestions to help tell people what to say. No, great thoughts. Great thoughts. Hey, I hope you noticed that we kind of like to have fun, right? We're not, try not to be too uptight. So, enough in this world to get uptight about. So, if we're celebrating the grace of God, it's a good thing. So, you know how your favorite television shows will sometimes begin a new episode with the phrase, previously on The Walking Dead. I'm not sure why The Walking Dead does that, since each new episode is basically what has happened in every other episode, but I digress. The point is that sometimes it's necessary to know what has happened in order for the current narrative to make sense. And the story that we're going to look at today in Joshua as we continue this series is kind of like that. So, previously in the Bible, God created the world and everything in it, and it was good. God says so 7 times in the first 31 verses of Genesis. That's like every 5 verses, God looks around and goes, yeah, this is good. But we humans decided that instead of trusting God, we would try to find our own way. And the good world that God created was plunged into a struggle for power, that didn't just pit us against God, it pitted us against each other and even the planet. Men and women fought each other for dominance. Children were pitted against parents, parents against children, people against people. In fact, at the beginning of Genesis chapter 4, Cain, a man named Cain, kills his brother Abel, murders him. And at the end of chapter 4, a man named Lamech doesn't just kill another man, he writes a poem celebrating the murder. By the time you get to Genesis chapter 6, God's estimation of us is that every, and this is straight out of the Bible, every inclination of the human heart was only evil all the time. Things are a mess. And there's only one man, Noah, who is considered righteous, and you've heard about Noah and the ark and the great flood. That was God's way of starting over. But even before the mud from the flood dried, we were back to our old tricks, which were excess and exploitation of each other, of the planet. But in Genesis chapter 11, we try to get things back on track ourselves. We try to find our own way to security and significance, and we decide, here's what we'll do. We'll build this great city, Babel, and we'll build a great tower, and that way we'll make a name for ourselves, and we'll have security, and we'll have significance, and we'll have all the things that we've ever wanted, and we're trying to do that without God. This is in Genesis chapter 11. Now, the interesting assessment that God makes here, chapter 11, verse 6, God says, if as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Which at first sounds really hopeful. I mean, yeah, we can do anything. Until you go back and look at history, brief though it is at this point, everything we've tried to do was evil. So you got people with great potential, but all they plan is evil, and so God has to save us from ourselves. So he scatters us. He frustrates our language. Then in Genesis chapter 12, God begins to reveal his ultimate plan. He's got a plan. He's got a path. And so out of all the people on the planet, and you and I would not have chosen this guy, but God chooses this most unlikely guy named Abram, as we know him later, Abraham, and his wife Sarai, or as she is later known, Sarah, and he makes a promise to them. And here's his promise. I will make you into a great nation. You don't need to go out there and try to find your own way and build your own greatness. I'll do that for you, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great. You don't have to fight for significance. I'm going to make that possible for you, and you'll be a blessing. And then God says this, all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. The very things that we had been fighting for and dreaming of, and trying to find our own way to security and significance and freedom and a future, God is offering free of charge, unmerited gift. It's like he's telling us, those places that you want to get to, I will take you there. Just follow me. Now, do you remember when you were a kid and your parents would take you to Disney World or somewhere, and you would do this long car ride in the back seat? Remember the question you always ask your parents? Are we there yet? Right? That's not exactly how Abraham framed it, but that question and the impatience that inspired it drove him to make some really bad choices along the way. Instead of trusting God and following God's lead and doing whatever God told him, Abraham took some shortcuts. And in some ways, we're still paying for those shortcuts. But God has always been way more patient than we are. And God kept his promise, and Abraham did become a great nation, and that's who we know as the children of Israel. But the descendants of Abraham were no more patient than their patriarch, and to tell you the truth, I don't know if it was because of their impatience or God's way of weeding it out of them, breeding it out of them, but the descendants of Abraham had to endure 400 years of slavery in Egypt, and then finally, God leads them out of that miserable existence through a man named Moses. Maybe you saw the movie, God sent the 10 terrible plagues on Egypt, and Pharaoh finally let the people go. They crossed the Red Sea on dry land. They camped out at a mountain called Sinai. God gave them the 10 commandments. And then God led Israel right through the wilderness, right up to the border of the promised land, the land that God had promised he was going to give Abraham. There they are. That now, instead of slaving away their lives working for others, they work for themselves. Now, instead of building cities for an Egyptian dictator, they live in cities that somebody else has built. Instead of waking up in a strange place every single morning, they get to wake up in a place called home. They hold the deed, they get to hold the deed to the land they walk on. And instead of following God right into this new life, they hesitate. In fact, they beg God to let them go back to Egypt, back to what they knew, back to slavery. How many times do we do that? Which is basically like standing at the gate of Disney World after your parents have taken vacation time and put new tires in the station wagon and bought the tickets and you telling them, I want to go back home. That would not sit well with your parents, and it did not sit well with God. And so for another 40 years, Israel had to wander in the wilderness. Another 40 years of asking, are we there yet? And with the book of Joshua, the answer is yes, we are there. We just covered like a million years of history in 5 minutes. Look with me in Joshua chapter 3. I want to look at just the first five verses this morning. Joshua chapter 3. That's kind of over toward the beginning of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua. Like the sixth. I always get nervous when I start that because I think I'm going to forget one of these. So Joshua chapter 3. If you have to look it up on your index, that's fine. Don't worry about it. Or you can use your device. Either way. First five verses. Here we go. Early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out from Shittim and went to the Jordan, the river, where they camped before crossing over. That phrase in the next several chapters, crossing over, that's kind of an important phrase. As you read through the next few chapters of Joshua, kind of be looking for that one. After 3 days, this is verse 2, after 3 days, the officers went throughout the camp, giving orders to the people, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the Levitical priests carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. But keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the ark, 3,000 feet, and do not go near it. Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. I think you can sum up those five verses with three words. And I'll tell you what the first word is in just a minute. But the first thing the people are told to do is to keep their eyes on the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord their God. You saw Raiders of the Lost Ark, so you kind of know what we're talking about here. The Ark was Israel's most sacred symbol. It was a chest that contained three things. It had the stone tablets on which were written the Ten Commandments. An author named Brian McLaren said that through the ten plagues, God got Israel out of slavery, and through the Ten Commandments, God got the slavery out of Israel. Pretty cool way to look at that. So the ark represents, in part, God's law, because God's law is in there. The second thing in the ark was Aaron's rod. Aaron was the brother of Moses. Moses was the guy who led Israel out of Egypt. Aaron was his brother. Aaron was the spiritual leader of Israel. He was the priest. And at one point in their wanderings, there was a group of people who rebelled against Moses and Aaron, and they were like, you know, we think somebody else ought to get to be priest. Who are you, Aaron, to act like you're everybody's spiritual boss? And so we think somebody else ought to be boss. And so God told the Israelites, take one staff, one walking stick from each tribe, put them in a pile. And so they all did. And Aaron's staff, the one from Levi, is the one that budded. There's a stick that's been cut off from the tree, and it blossoms, and it produces almonds. And so the people go, well, okay then, I guess Aaron's the guy, right? He's the one that's supposed to lead us. So the ark represents God's law, but it also represents God's leadership. And then the third thing that was in the ark was a bowl, and inside the bowl was something called manna. The word manna means, what is it? It was the sweet, flaky, power breakfast bread that God provided the Israelites for food while they were in the wilderness. I read one guy who said it was kind of like frosted flakes. So every morning Israel got up and went, they're great, right? Probably not. But it did keep them alive in a harsh land, and so the ark represented God's provision, God's love. So law, leadership, and love. That's what the ark represented. God's loving, leading presence among his people. So why were they to keep their eyes on the ark? Here's the first word that summarizes these verses: direction. When the command was given, the priests were to pick up this chest, the Ark of the Covenant, and lead Israel into the promised land. And that was going to be their roadmap, their GPS. They needed that direction because they had never, this is what Joshua, the leaders among people said, you've never been this way before. You need this direction. So one of the reasons I wanted us to go back over those previous episodes, starting in the Garden of Eden, we have consistently chosen to go our own way instead of following God's direction. And every single time we did that, every single time we do that, catastrophe ensues. It's like every single human being in the world is a male driver who refuses to ask directions. Am I the only one in the room who has ever driven 20 miles in the wrong direction on the interstate because I was too proud to admit I was lost? How many tanks of gas have I burned because I thought I knew where I was going? And I'm not even going to ask you to confess this, but how many of you have listened to your GPS tell you where to go and said, I know a better way? You know what? The little lady on my GPS, on my phone, the word she uses most often is recalculating. Because I don't listen. Look, you and I are really no different than the Israelites are. We need that direction. And yet, do you know what the most dominant sentiment in our culture is these days? Find your own truth. Look within to find your way. For all of life's answers, all you need to do is to look inside yourself. Now, I'm not trying to pick on Oprah. Okay, but I read this last week, like Thursday, and I thought, good grief, there's a great example of this. So you hear it from anybody, but I've heard it most recently from Oprah. She's promoting her newest movie, and she was talking to an audience of young girls, and here's what she said. Every one of us has an internal guidance, a GPS, an intuition, a heart print, a heart song that speaks to us. And if you will follow that, you will be led to the highest good for you always. No, you won't. I don't know about you. I have looked within me, and I can tell you it is not pretty. I have listened to my heart song. It is confused, conflicted, and chaotic. My heart song is out of tune. I'm as much in need of direction as the next guy, and so are you. We're no different from the Israelites at the border of the promised land. They needed direction, because they had never been that way before. And there's a place you and I've never been either. That's called tomorrow. And we have no idea what we're going to encounter there. If you had told me 4 years ago, if you'd said, Jody, in 4 years you'll be preaching in Huntsville, Alabama, and you're going to love every minute of it, I would have said, you're crazy. I'll never wind up in Huntsville, Alabama. And yet, here I am. This past week, a family member of one of our church members was getting ready to be discharged from the hospital. All he had to do was take one more breathing treatment, and he was going to get to go home. He never made it through that breathing treatment. He never got to go home. You do not know what's going to happen tomorrow. You and I don't even know what's going to happen in the next 10 minutes. We don't. We have no idea. Which is why knowing that we have God's law
and God's leadership and God's love to guide us is so important. We don't know what tomorrow is going to be like because we've never been there, but God has. He's been there. He can direct us. Second word that summarizes these five verses is the word preparation. Joshua, in verse 5, Joshua tells the people, consecrate yourselves. The word consecrate means to set something apart for a holy purpose. You ever heard the word sanctify? It means the same thing. Both of those words, consecrate and sanctify, sound almost too religious to be of any use. But they're not, because we consecrate things all the time. When a young couple is about to have a baby, what do? They come home, they pick out a room, they repurpose that room. They paint the walls an appropriate color. They move out all the old furniture. They put in a baby bed and a crib and a changing table and all the other stuff that they're going to need. They put those little plastic plug thingies in all the electrical outlets, right? They are preparing that room. They are consecrating that room. They're getting it ready. When an athlete is facing a big competition, what does she do? She spends months and weeks training, developing her body for endurance and performance and trying to get her body so ready to perform in that event that it's just automatic for her. The day of the event, she eats right, she warms up, she stretches, she thinks through how she's going to face the competition. She is consecrating herself, preparing herself to perform her best. And this happens all the time in the Bible. When God gave Moses the Ten Commandments, first thing God says is, Moses, tell the people to consecrate themselves, to get themselves ready to receive the law. Before Jesus came on the scene, there was a prophet named John the Baptist. He came to prepare the people for the arrival of Jesus. He told them to repent, to change. There's another Bible word we don't use enough. And to be baptized to get ready for Jesus. And you know, and of course, everybody loves Jesus, right? He's the most famous. Everybody loves Jesus. Even Jesus spent 40 days and nights fasting in the wilderness to prepare himself, to consecrate himself for his ministry. Our relationship with God is like that. If we want to follow God's direction, if we want to witness God do something amazing in our lives, we have to consecrate ourselves. That's going to mean different things for different people. But it usually involves two things. It means eliminating some things from your life and adding others. Consecration may require you to change how you spend your time. It may require you to change who you spend your time with. May have an impact on what you read. I think our Bible reading plan that we're into this year, and if you haven't joined us yet, come on, get in this. Just pick up where we are. Go to our website, to the Read Scripture, download the Read Scripture app. There's information downstairs. Call Steve Krieger. He'll tell you everything that you need to know about it. Just jump in with us. I think that reading Scripture plan is a way that our church is consecrating. We are consecrating ourselves for God to do something amazing. Consecration will affect the websites you visit. Consecration will affect what you put into your body, how you spend your money, the language that you use. And I think the mistake we make is that we tend to think that all of those disciplines and habits and all of that self-denial and sobriety and all that moderation and self-control, all of those characteristics of consecration, we think that's what it means to be a Christian, that they are the end result. That's what we're aiming for, that's what it's all about. But those are not the ends. That's not what it's all about. They are that all of those efforts at consecration are a means to an end. Consecration is what prepares us for God to do something amazing in our lives, in our homes, in our schools, in our places of work, in our church. I worry about this sometimes. I worry that we do all this hard work to discipline ourselves and set ourselves apart and sanctify ourselves, and then we go, is that it? Because I don't feel like anything amazing has happened. And then we quit. right before God amazes us. Because consecration, setting ourselves apart, is not the main event. It's what prepares us for the main event. And that brings us to the last word that summarizes these five verses. Anticipation. Direction, preparation, anticipation. Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. Anticipation. Something good's going to happen. When they think about what's going to happen tomorrow, some folks feel only anxiety. It's like they live in a Hitchcock movie, and they're always waiting for the next jump scene, something bad. Anticipation and anxiety sound a lot alike, but they're second cousins, twice removed at best. Anxiety is the sense that something bad is about to happen. Anticipation is the sense that something good is about to happen. Anticipation is the groom standing at the altar the second before the doors open and his bride walks in. It's the bride standing in the back just as the doors open. Anticipation is the reason your mouth waters when you're walking the dog in the afternoon through the neighborhood and somebody's grilling steak. Anticipation is the feeling you get when you sit down, finally, and open the first page of a book you've been wanting to read for ages. The sense that something good is about to happen. Joshua told Israel, prepare yourselves. God is about to amaze you. Because everybody needs a next. Something to look forward to. You're probably already thinking about the vacation you're going to take this summer. Kids need Christmas morning and birthdays. Old folks need to mark the days on the calendar until the grandkids come for a visit. Winter needs the first flowers of spring. If we follow God's direction, if we consecrate ourselves, then we get to live with anticipation. Even when everything around us seems to be coming apart at the seams, we can live expectantly. Billy Graham, just a couple of years ago, said, I look forward, you're going to believe he said this, I look forward to death with anticipation because then I get to see God face to face. Can you imagine what it would be like if you could live even in the face of death with excitement and enthusiasm and anticipation? If death was not the grim reaper who stalks the shadows, but is simply the thing that's going to usher you into the presence of God. You know, he wants to bang on the door and scatter us like frightened children, but if we're living with God's direction, if we've consecrated ourselves, then we receive death, not as something to be afraid of. We welcome death because that's going to take us to be with our Father. That would be an awesome way to live. How's that even possible? Because wherever you go, God has already been, even death. Jesus has been there and back, and he will show you the way if you are willing to follow. A few years ago, I got to go to Russia on a week-long mission trip, and the friend, the missionary that took me, has lived there and worked there, speaks the language, knows the territory, and the highlight of the sightseeing portion of this trip was going, for me, was going to be to get to go to Red Square. I was going to get to see Red Square, see the Kremlin, St. Basil's Cathedral, and just be there where all of that history has been made. And so we took a train into Moscow, and we got off the train, and we're walking up a hill toward Red Square, and it was February, so it was really cold. It was snowing. It was beautiful. And as we're getting toward the top of the hill, Rob stopped me and he said, I want you to wait right here. And I said, why? He said, just wait right here. And he walked on up ahead of me and then he turned around and he said, okay, now come. And so I ran up the hill and then I saw for the first time in my life, Red Square, and took it all in, and we did the tours and everything. And later on, I remembered, and I said, why did you ask me to wait before I topped it? Why did you go ahead of me like that? He said, I always do that because I want to turn around and see what people look like, see the look on their face when they finally see what they've been waiting for. You know what I think? I think God does that. I think God leads us right up to the edge and says, wait. Because he wants to turn around and he wants to see the looks on our faces when the anticipation becomes reality. And it is awesome if we'll follow his lead and prepare ourselves. He will do amazing things for us. How about we pray over that? Why don't we all stand? Let's pray. And then Lincoln's going to lead us in a song. God, we are no different than all who came before us. We try to find our own way. We think we can do it all by ourselves. We believe in our potential more than you do. And yet, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know that when we try to do life without you, when we try to achieve success or significance or security or freedom or whatever it is we try to do, we just make a mess of things. And some of us have made messes in our lives right now. We're just a mess. So we're so thankful for the message that we've been hearing all morning, that you know us through and through, but you love us, that the foot of the cross is where we find your grace and mercy, that if we will follow your direction and prepare ourselves, you will do something amazing in our lives. And I just pray this morning that we'll do that. I pray that each of us will think very carefully about what it's going to take to consecrate ourselves, to prepare ourselves for you to do something great in our lives, and that we will do what needs to be done, eliminate what needs to be eliminated, add what needs to be added. And God, I pray that we can live with the anticipation of what you are going to do to us, for us, in us, and through us. Thank you for being the God who walks every step of the way with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Promise maker, promise keeper, you finish what you begin. Our provision through the desert, you see it through to the end. You see it through to the end. The Lord our faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. In the silence, in the waiting, still we can know you are good. Your plans are for your glory. Yes, we can know you are good. Yes, we can know you are good. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this dark the Lord our God.
We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. from this darkness. You will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God.
And the whole church said,
amen.
Have a great week. Let's close in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercy, and we thank you for your grace, and we pray as we leave this building and our friends and brothers and sisters that we will also show mercy, and we shall also show grace to others. Be with us as we leave. In Christ, we pray. Amen.